So, very warm welcome to all of you, respected Consulate General and the speakers, to this conference on States of India. And I would like to give a brief introduction to this whole campaign, and then would like to invite the respected Consulate General to kickstart the conference today. This conference is taking place in three cities. We started in 20th of March in Hamburg, and today it's in Frankfurt. On 3rd of June, we'll be doing it in Munich. The whole objective of this conference is to promote Indo-German business collaboration through risk-sharing partnerships. And today's speakers are very distinguished people from their respective backgrounds and organizations. Will be giving us some details about those particular topics that they are representing. And now, may I request Consulate General to kindly please come up and open today's conference.
This is Mr. from PwC, Mr. Oliver Rapp from DNA, Mr. Yoke Model from President GI at Düsseldorf, Mr. Nagraj, and Bobby. Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all here and thanks Bobby for organizing this conference here. I just talked with you and I found out that it's mainly focusing on southern India and for investment opportunities. We already have various initiatives here. There are a lot of speakers, but today I'll just briefly tell you about India and Germany trade and investment scenario. India-Germany is the largest partner for Indo-German trade. In the last year, we have Indo-German trade was valued at Euro 21 billion, and the trade has been increasing. The Germany is also the largest foreign direct investor, seventh largest foreign direct investor in India. And the total investment, foreign direct FDA, can be valued at $10 billion, more than 10 billion. There are around 600 joint ventures between India and Germany and 1600 collaborations. So looking at the Indo-German trade scenario, I think we are at a good pace among all the European countries, but there is a lot of scope to increase investment between both countries, like Indian investment in Germany and also German investment in India. There are around 200 Indian companies who have invested in Germany. And I would just like briefly, we are right now going through the election phase and we are waiting for the results. But I would just like to briefly mention you that in last 4 years or 5 years, we have undertaken several structural reforms. The major among them are GST. There were separate taxes for different states in India, and all these taxes have been merged into the GST. We have also had IPR reforms. Foreign direct investment is also now 90% foreign direct investment is also possible. So various structural reforms have been undertaken to improve investment scenario in India, and India is a major investment destination just because we are growing so fast in a few years. We have the largest youth population. We have undertaken several structural reforms, and then we have a large domestic market. So all these factors are reflecting on the fact that we are a major investment destination country. Our government has undertaken several initiatives like Startup India, Invest India, Digital India, Smart Cities. So all these initiatives are offering several opportunities for investment. Invest India is created by Government of India and FICCI joint venture, which helps or guides companies to invest in India. They provide information on tax rates. They provide information on availability of skilled labor. They provide information on rules and regulations of pertaining to various states. So these are all various initiatives, and our embassy has started an initiative called Making India Middle Stand to help mainly small and medium enterprises to invest in India. So with these various investment, we have improved rank in ease of doing business report, which was published in World Bank last year. So we were ranked at 77 among 190 countries, and we improved rank of almost 65 ranks. We achieved a rise of 65 ranks in just a period of 4 years. So this we could achieve because all the factors that I mentioned earlier. So this is a general scenario as I would like to tell you, but I think it's much better to listen about all the initiatives and their impact from various people who are already dealing with India. So I'm very happy that we have such good speakers today, and I look forward to listen to you. Thank you.
So we have today's agenda where the next speaker is Mr. Oliver Wack from PDMA.
Oh, really?
And we initially thought of having the question and answer sessions at the end, but looking at the numbers, I think we can handle it straight away after the presentation, so that if there are any questions, we don't miss the last point. If it is okay with the speakers to go like that, okay, good. So, may I invite Mr. Oliver Wack to please come up and take us through the presentation.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm a little bit surprised I was on number 4 in the beginning, now I've moved up. Yeah, Madam Spinkler, everybody, thank you very much for giving BDMA and myself the opportunity to throw a spotlight on the current situation of bilateral trade, bilateral relationship in the mechanical engineering industry. I will stay close to my 10 minutes, and therefore you concentrate in this direction because you don't see any slides. lately, how is the development? Let me give you a few facts. The capital goods industry is basically not connected to the overall growth scenario, for example, in India. So from 2012 to 2015, our exports, for example, and our business within the country decreased significantly every year compared to the other year before. So one could say, how come you could not participate in that kind of growth? That is because our industry is related to the investment activities of our customer branches and not to the overall growth. Lucky us, in 2016, we experienced a turnaround, and for the last 3 years, we were back, so to say, on the road, and we experience now 3 years in a row a growth in our exports to India. We now have the figures for the first 2 months of 2019, and what we experience now is that we have a flat, so to say, development. The level of business of exports out of Germany is on the same level as compared to the first 2 months of last year. But business with India is not a one-way street. On the other hand, for 5, 6, 7 years now, we experience a growth of imports from India in the engineering field and the mechanical engineering field to Germany. And last year, for example, compared to 2017, it was 10%, which is a good result. And overall, we expect also a further growth this year. India is, for our industry in Asia, the second most important market after China, but so to say, the difference is still very, very high. The difference is very large. We have roughly 3 billion euros exports to India, and last year we had about 19 billion euros exports to China. So on the other hand, we see a lot of potential and a lot of opportunities. The engineering industry, not only in Germany, but also in Europe, is structured on its medium-sized enterprises basis. So currently, BDMA consists of 3,250 member companies in Germany, all with production in Germany, and about 85% of them have a workforce below 250 people in Germany. On the other hand, our export ratio is 80% in average, okay? So that means basically put it in the picture, 4 out of 5 machines are leaving Germany, and therefore especially Asia, and our largest pillar is the European Union, is very important. Since 2 years, as I said, India is number 2 most important market after China, and we expect also further growth in the next years. For 20 years now we are active in India. We have 4 offices over there, and we employ 12 people in all the different corners which are important for the business in India. Currently about 550 member companies are active in India under their own name. We don't count the ones who are active with traders or so. And lately the interest was is picking up, and we expect more investment to come. But I have to mention, one is the overall frame environment of the business, and Madam mentioned, for example, some incentives and so on. But also when we talked in the third floor before we came down here, first you have to have a market. That's the point. First you have to have a market, and you have to sell something, and you can start with some activities in the service and after sales area, and then in a later stage, probably then you can set up an assembly or a production. From these 550 member companies, roughly 150 have an assembly or a production. So there's still a lot of potential and a lot of opportunities in the market. What are the major challenges for our companies? I'd like to mention that. Since 2009, China is by far the most important importer or exporter to India when you look on the figures. Roughly 1/3 is coming from the country. Of course, we have some subsidiaries in China who do business with India. On the other hand, that we know India is a price-sensitive market, so you look on the technical performance, and if the technical performance is fine and the price is low, then also you the customers in India are most likely ready then also to buy in other countries like China and Taiwan, for example, or Korea. Why do I mention that? Of course, we are not afraid of competition and so on, but you have to understand, as I said before, if you don't have a market, you don't invest. You don't set up your own subsidiary, you don't employ people, you don't educate people. And that is what we always used to say. I know that money issue in India is always very tight, and return of investment is very, 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 very important, especially for the local companies. However, an investment you also have to justify. And we have to understand small and medium-sized enterprises, most of them family-owned, they cannot set up a subsidiary like 1 year they go to Thailand, next year they go to India, and then again and again. That is not possible. It's not always because of the money, it's also because of the lack of people. You need also have to have the people for your setups. So when we have our annual meeting with our members last year in September, we have been to Pune, and we could receive more than 200 people from the management of our local companies. So everybody is quite excited, and everybody was in a good mood that time, and that continues also for this year. So meaning that the companies who are already in the country have a good perspectives, and they give us a good feedback on the development this year. Most of them are located in the Thane, Mumbai, Pune area, and the Chennai, Coimbatore, Bangalore triangle down there. So that is also related to the fact that the engineering industry itself, that's also the case in India, is also its largest customer. So then there's no wonder that, or it's not surprising, there's no surprise that the member companies also invest where probably the production chain or the supply chain is already there. Coming back for the last 2 minutes to the importance. When we talk about states in India and what they provide and what is important for German business, for setup and investment, and trying to use all the opportunities, I would put 3 points. I like to make 3 points. One is definitely very clear: skilled labor. Education is of the essence. And nowadays, on a regular basis, our member companies, they invest and they set up their own training centers, their own training facilities, and they train the people they need for their own production and for their own setup. We are, every time we are visiting India, also we go to Delhi and to other places, and we are also, of course, interacting with ministries and people from the administration to draw their attention to this very important issue. The European, and especially the German engineering industry, is a technology-driven industry. This is how we distinguish from others. This is how we make our business. These are the advantages we can give to our customers. And therefore, we need people who can handle this. We need people who can service this. We need people who can produce the goods in the country. And that is of the essence for our industry. And as the so-called Fortune 500 are already there in India, that's why when I talk with representatives of different states, then I'm telling them, put your efforts in this area and you will attract all the Mittelstand from Europe. Land is very important. Lately, prices went up, and also you are not always able to utilize the land you can buy. So definitely, we have some member companies, they really want to intensify their business, they really want to grow. And unfortunately, for example, Pune area, Bangalore area, Thane area, they don't find a place close by, a larger base close by. And if you move away 150, 200 kilometers, probably you will lose half of your workforce, and that is not justified to do so, because you need the qualified people for everything. So that is definitely also an issue, and there, when we have our talks in India, that's why we also pay a lot of attention to that. With the GST, I have to admit, we have a good feedback from our member companies regarding the implementation of the GST. Life is much easier than before. Lately, we went to Chandigarh, and our member company there in the agricultural machinery, they told us now from Chandigarh, taking the machinery down, for example, to Bangalore, they could reduce the traveling time 3 days. So that is very good. They don't need 1 week or longer. They can go down there in 3 days. So that was a very good action from the government. However, still the import levies and duties are on a quite high level, a little bit too high probably, because you know when you come from the high-end sector, then of course your price is related to the performance of the good you sell. And if we look on that still, it would be great if India and the European Union, sometime in the future maybe, are ready and would be able to conclude a free trade agreement. Unfortunately, since 2015, talks are stalled. We are advocating for free trade all the time, because as engineering industry, we only have offensive interests. And this week I was in Brussels, and the DG Trade of the European Commission mentioned that there are some promising talks with the Indian administration to restart again these negotiations. We are very much convinced that this is of the advantage of both our countries and regions, and so we hope that there will be some improvement in the near future. Thanks again. I hope it was of value to you what I told you. Thank you.
So maybe we take questions now itself.
Oh, sorry. Are there any questions? Was that interesting for you? I hope so.
There's no question, of course. It's small. My name is Mahesh Gandhi. I'm Dr. Mahesh Gandhi.
Mr. Gandhi.
I manage my own investment bank. We have been in business and infrastructure in India for the last 25 years. We set up our operations here in Germany only 2 years ago.
Okay.
We are investing primarily in infrastructure, but I also have an advisory division where we support implementation of export projects in India. One of them, of course, is heavy machinery supplies.
Mm.
We face phenomenal challenge there,
okay.
Especially from Hermes.
From?
Hermes.
Hermes?
So you're a Hermes? Your export credit agency?
Hermes, okay, I'm sorry. Hermes,
my
okay.
My pronunciation might be bad.
No, I'm in line, I'm sorry.
Apologies for that.
Yeah.
The challenges that we face are related to machinery being manufactured by German companies,
yes,
or being assembled by German companies, off-site in India. Many of your companies have subsidiaries in India, which are manufacturing machinery, which do not qualify under the ECA program.
Yes, could be. Yeah.
Are you doing anything? Can you to address this? The policy of SACE, which are the Italians,
yes.
The policy of Finnwerder from Finland or from others is very different. If anything is being manufactured by a subsidiary in India, they very much consider it as a part of export from their country.
Yeah.
Whereas it doesn't happen in your case.
I'm aware of the topic. I don't want to take too much time away from my colleagues here, but I'd like to mention that as VDMA is the largest industry association in Europe, we have 500 people here in Frankfurt. In my department also there's a colleague who takes care of export financing and is definitely aware of this issue, and probably would be a good idea if you address if you address that to her. But I can assure you that there are also some regulations of the Reserve Bank of India which makes life not so easy. I mean, you were mentioning Hermes, it's fine, I know they are challenging and not always all the goods are qualifying, that's true. On the other hand, lately we had a case where the business was stopped to a regulation of the Reserve Bank of India because you are not allowed, for example, as a down payment or the fee for the whole transaction, you are not allowed to put on, for example, Hermes or any other insurance company. This is not allowed. But please understand, the world in this financing issues is quite complicated, and as I said before, the most business is done by small and medium-sized enterprises. We are advocating for Hermes and for opening up all the time, but also on the other hand, you have to have the companies and the people in the companies to perform that. Yeah? But if you have feedback like that, it's no problem. I give you the contact of my colleague and you can exchange with her. She's very much acquainted with the topic. Yeah?
Love to meet her.
Of course, you're always welcome to visit VDMA, please.
But I have a question regarding the trained members, skilled. The 3 points, the first point was
Yes.
And my question is like, could you find some solutions like looking at the process, how such skilled manpower is available locally here in Germany, and what are those enabling factors in Germany to have such kind of manpower to the same companies here? Is it possible that some of those mechanisms are copyable or implementable in India?
From my point of view, everything is possible in that area. But you have to understand the mindset is very different. Over here, for example, we have this dual education system. Yeah? We have also a dual education system for university level. So, but if you talk to an Indian company, then the Indian owner, he probably would say, why should I pay this guy when he goes 3 months to school? In that time, he's not with me, he's not working for me, and so on and so on. So that mentality is also an issue. In Germany, our companies pay these people for pleasure. It's true, because even if someone is leaving you after the education, he's in the market, he's available, he goes, and someone from another company might join you. You raise the overall level. From my personal experience, I would like to say it's also very often related to people. You have this, what is it called, ITIs in India. There are some professors, some colleagues, they are open, they are active, they are actively seeking the contact to foreign companies of the technical engineering field, also to German companies, and they try to work together. On the other hand, we have member companies. I just lately had a chat with a colleague. He said, I approached these people in the ITI, we made a class, I sent a guy over to explain them what are sensors about. How do sensors work? Why are sensors very important? And then I personally visited this college after 3 months, 4 months, and then I entered his office and our products were in the corner and there were no more classes available. So that's also, it's an Indian gentleman, it's not me, it's just what they are telling us. So we have a lot of challenges in our cooperation and working together, but basically overall it is important not only for our industry, but for whole India to raise a little bit the education level. What we need to our experience, qualified education is probably between 5 or 10% of the people who leave their education, schools or universities or colleges. So that makes life, even if you want to engage in India, that is a real, real challenge. And when you are in places like Pune, Thane, Bangalore or so, then the pressure, that's why I said, and I like Coimbatore very much, because there, the pressure still is not so high on the workforce than in other places, because everybody is looking for good educated people. That's true. Yeah. But for our people, this is a very important issue. Thanks. Are you fine?
Okay. Great. Thank you very much. That was a nice presentation. Now we move on to our next speaker. I invite Ms. Winkler. Before that, I would like to present a state-specific video of Telangana, what this state has to offer us.
Welcome to Telangana, India's newest state and a gateway to Asia. At the heart of Telangana beats its vibrant capital, Hyderabad, known as the City of Pearls. Hyderabad is the fifth largest metropolitan in India. This 400-year-old city sees the traditional and modern coexist in perfect harmony and offers its patrons experiences worth treasuring. In fact, Mercer's Quality of Living Report 2015 has ranked Hyderabad among the best livable cities globally. It is also on National Geographic's Must Visit City list. Hyderabad is the preferred destination for locals, tourists and industries alike, thanks to its moderate temperatures all year round. What also makes it a favorite choice is the fact that it is a non-cyclonic and non-seismic zone. Another feather in Hyderabad's cap is its Metro Ring project. The project, even before completion, has been lauded as one of the most future-forward projects in the world. It has also been setting many firsts in India. Its burgeoning economy, mainly in the fields of IT, finance, pharmaceuticals and biotechnology, and aerospace, is ably supported by well-connected air routes and future-centric city infrastructure. Little wonder that it is called the new economy hub in India. Telangana, with an urban population of 42%, is one of the world's most investment-friendly destinations. A revenue surplus state, it has everything the world needs to set up the next-gen state-of-the-art industries. Its proactive government, minimum inspection, maximum facilitation policy, easy self-certification approval process, and 24/7 power supply gives companies all the confidence they need to make Telangana their dream business hub. In fact, Telangana's industrial policy explicitly highlights guidelines for easy setup of industries, from timely clearances and a single window service to a fair and transparent approval process. For the first lot, project approvals were given within 12 days. Telangana's three industrial corridors have in place modern infrastructure, 148 ready-to-occupy industrial parks, 27 SEZs, and a pre-approved land bank of 150,000 acres. A number of national and international companies are already running successfully across varied sectors. Telangana is known as the IT hub of India, and the state's IT prowess has not gone unnoticed by India and the world. The state is also home to the defense industry, textile industry, auto manufacturing industry, healthcare industry, and the power industry. To help supply a steady stream of industry-ready manpower, Telangana built some of the world's best educational institutions. Come, let your ambition take flight at Telangana.
Great. So, we have a boss here.
Yes. Thank you very much. I like very much the video about Hyderabad, even though we don't consider 43 degrees to be moderate, right? For us, it's striking. But yeah, it's a great place. Yeah, I see mainly Indians here, so my topic is Indian tax law. I don't know whether what I'm going to tell you is familiar to you, but I'll try it anyhow, and if you have any questions, just let me know. So 10 minutes is very short, so I can only cover and scratch the surface a little bit, but basically, what I basically will talk about is which entity do I choose when I enter the Indian market? Are there any current investment incentives, particularly as regards to the states that are in the focus today? And are there certain pitfalls that we should avoid when we invest in India? So on the legal entity structure, before I start with the legal entity, of course, Oliver Vakki mentioned right away, is there a market for your business? And before you start opening an entity, you might want to do some research, you want to do some market your products also and see, you know, what is their feasibility, is it a good idea to invest in India? And if you're coming from the corporate side, of course, you won't just start off right with an entity, but you might consider to go there and just have a look. And if you do this for quite a long time, more than 6 months, for example, you might run into the risk that you are already taxable in India with a branch or PE, permanent establishment. So to avoid that, there is a possibility to open a liaison office in India, which is not for the purpose of earning money, but for market research, for marketing your own products to see whether you can basically, this is the right place for you. So having said that, and you have then decided to open your business there, you can do it either via establishing a company. Company being a small company or a normal company, a private, can you read that? You look so critically.
I'm just looking at the numbers.
At the numbers, basically, yeah. But forget the numbers for a moment, I'm just saying a private company or public company similar to, or like our GmbH or AG, whether the shares are publicly offered or not. Private companies may not offer their shares. Be it that you operate through a branch or a limited liability partnership under the LLP Act since 2008, this is possible for foreign investments only recently. So from a tax perspective, it makes, of course, a big difference. Is every entity or vehicle the right vehicle for you? This is the question. If you want to manufacture in India, you might not be able to do that by a branch or an LLP. You would have to establish an entity, but if you're just distributing in India, a branch is a feasible option, or LLP. Mostly service industries or IT service providers, distributors might consider to go on the right side via a branch or LLP. There are certain pitfalls, of course. Branch is not a legal entity as such, so you would have to calculate your branch profit before you submit it to tax. And this is always a little bit tricky because there might be disputes with the tax authorities. Sometimes it's easier to have a company as an own legal separate entity with its own calculation. So there are certain issues around. On the tax side, which is my focus, it makes a huge difference. Not only looking at the tax rate on top, the figures are odd, but as you know, the smaller enterprises which have sales not more than 250 Indian crores are taxed at 25% plus cess, charges. The normal companies at 30% plus cess. The branch looks to be taxed the highest with 43.7%, which is at the end of the day not the case, because this is not the end. You have to look at the lower row. And the LLPs seem to be quite attractive too. So, however, if you look at the tax burden after distribution, you will easily see that the company as such might not be so attractive, because if you distribute dividends, you have a dividend distribution tax which comes on top. it's not a withholding tax, you know. It's not credited in your home country here, but it's an additional corporate tax in India. So from a tax perspective, things look different, and this is what you have to consider when you invest in India. Coming to financing or funding, there are certain funding instruments in place, starting off with the equity on the left side and the debentures on the right side, external commercial borrowings, recently being liberalized and becoming more and more attractive in India. So for India business, because you cannot only invest into enlarging your business, but also in use the funds that you gain from ECBs for your operative purposes. I don't want to go into details about all that, but nowadays, since most of the foreign direct investments fall under the automatic route, it's only certain businesses which are still not automatically approved, which is print media or multi-brand retail supermarkets where you still need permission. Most of the investments fall under the automatic route, meaning that you just basically connect to an authorized dealer, give him your papers, and it's being permitted. Similar then to the funding, if you are in this sector which is under the automatic route, you also need no approval for the funding. The ECBs fall under certain regulations. So I will come later to that. In the middle part, I have added up the preference shares. And this is together with the CCDs and the CCPs. CCPS are both hybrid instruments between equity and debentures. So you might consider in a country where you have a very high tax rate to put some debentures loans into the country where you have interest being deducted from your taxable profit, which is possible. However, if you are financed via your group parent company, you have to know that only 30% of the EBITDA, the earning before income tax and depreciation, is deductible for tax purposes. So there are certain limitations to it. Still though, when you finance your Indian business, always consider how much equity do I put into the company, how much loan debentures do I put in there for the interest deduction, which is possible. On the equity side and the preference share side, of course, please consider dividends or buyback of shares is taxable. So that's quite a cost on that side. On the other side, interest payments on debentures or on ECBs are also taxed with a withholding on the interest at 10% at the moment, according to the double taxation treaty between Germany and India now, but most other treaties also provide a tax rate of 10%. So this is where we are at the moment. As regards the external commercial borrowings, there have been some recent updates, as I mentioned, particularly on the end-use restrictions. That is very much welcome because ECBs earlier were only allowed for enlarging your business. Nowadays, working capital purposes is part of it, which is good. And all the others which I mentioned here, I think the slides will be made available to you. I don't want to mention everything which is on there now at the moment, but ECBs are regulated in a way that there are some minimum average maturities depending on the end-use restrictions. Eligible borrowers are companies and LLPs nowadays, which is also good because earlier LLPs had to be financed via equity, and now ECBs are also a positive possible alternative. Acquisition structures, just on short note, if you don't want to do a greenfield investment, but you might consider to acquire any entity in India, either by a direct acquisition of shares or indirect acquisition of shares, you should be aware that this, the vendor, the seller, has taxable event in India when they sell their shares in an Indian entity. This is something which is very peculiar about India. So this might also increase the cost of acquisition because you are, as a buyer, are also liable for this tax if it's not paid. If you decide for indirect acquisition and you buy this structure as a total, you should look at the holding company. Is it in a very good jurisdiction? Is it a very good treaty framework? Are there stable laws and policies that the holding is situated? So there are certain things you should consider when you have a holding which holds the Indian shares. Other than that, one more remark on other ways and common acquisition structures you might be interested in. If there is a loss in the target co, that you just basically acquire the business out of the target, either by a demerger, merger, or sale of business from the vendor. So this is often also a chosen alternative for to acquire an Indian business. The positive side on that is that if there are any losses in the target co, you can actually do use these for tax purposes and put them against the sale. So the holding co, I mentioned these are the key parameters. In case you would like to go via a holding company, there might be some tax benefits. You need to have a look in detail if you decide to do that. Investment incentives, just on a short note, generally the state provides tax incentives if you invest in India. Particular research and development are subsidized by 100-150% of your expenditure if you do research in India. There are some incentives when you employ people, there are incentives for environmental measures that you put into your business. But additional to the national central incentives, there are of course state-owned key incentives, and they are pretty much the same. It's mostly GST reimbursement. You get subsidies on electricity power. There is stamp duty concession in all the states if you come in at a larger scale, particularly for mega projects. This is also the case in the case of Andhra Pradesh. Similar to Tamil Nadu. Tamil Nadu basically has segmented the area as per their development from A to C. A is more developed, C is less developed. So wherever you invest, you get more or less subsidies so that you can basically attract business in the right regions. But you said, Mr. Oliver, you said it's always a calculation, you know, you either go somewhere outside, but then you might not find the qualified people, so it's an overall package you have to look at. It's not just taxation or subsidies. So for example, for Tamil Nadu, stamp duty concession, again, reimbursement of indirect taxes, electricity subsidies, and then there's a special package also for the southern districts and for automotive. In Karnataka, again, for mega projects, stamp duty concession, GST, interest-free loans and subsidies, as a short note. Which brings me, I believe, to the end. Some pitfalls is basically only a summary of what I've said. Avoid overcapitalization, try to, because repatriation of capital becomes very expensive at an additional tax. If you do share buyback, avoid that. Use the right type of capital instrument for financing the business. Future repatriation of shares is very expensive. And invest, try to avoid to invest through a non-favorable jurisdiction. So, and this is it for the time. Do you have any questions? That's in India. 10 minutes.
I have one question actually. Yes. You from the last.
Yes. Sure.
At what point exactly a business initiative, if I may call it in that way, becomes tax liable? First in India,
yes.
And maybe how it is in Germany? Could you tell us?
Compare. Like yeah. I mean, yeah. It is. This is a very crucial point, as you said, because. If you are basically starting your business and you're not really, you just start negotiating contracts, this is a point where already, if you come from the corporate side, Indian tax authorities might assume that you have a permanent establishment in India. So once you start doing business and come away from auxiliary work, which is like setting up the office or just doing some arrangements finding contacts. But if you start negotiating, this is mostly, I mean, there's no exact point, of course, yeah, it's not easy to answer that question. But the issue that we are looking at is mostly with the branch and PE, permanent establishment taxation. And this is when you go away from pure auxiliary work, but into negotiation work. And negotiating agreements with your business partners. And being only that you start negotiating, but already, you know, this is critical. And then when you do start doing that, you should consider to set up the right structure to avoid that you are taxed at a point where you still feel it's only starting point, but nothing happened so far. And yeah, so I find in Germany, yes, it is the starting of a negotiation of an agreement might not, it's very unlikely to be taxable, but once you conclude the contract. So on that side, I would believe it's a little bit more relaxed here. So you have to be very careful. In India, another example is, 3 months in the country, or 6 months, 6 months mostly in the country, doing business, having a permanent, having a key to a room, which is in your hands, which you can use with the client on the client side, might already, there are certain pitfalls. So negotiation, having a room for your business, doing more than just auxiliary services. These are all events where you are likely to be taxed in India. Whereas in Germany, you really need to, you have an office in a way. It's not just the key to an office or somewhere, or you know, it's a longer period of time you can look at. It's more relaxed in a way. Yeah. But there is no way that I can really say this is exactly the point that it starts to be critical. Yeah. You should be a little bit more nervous in India about tax authorities looking at what you're doing. Yeah. I hope this helps in a way.
A follow-up question, then a German company who is then going into India might think India is like how they are in Germany.
Yes.
So what are the precautions that the German company, when it is going for some sort of initiative or negotiations or something like that, when they do not fall into this thing?
Yes. So either you set up a structure right away because you're determined to do business, and you say, okay, then I establish a PVT or go via I establish a branch, I'm open, it is a taxable event, yeah, in a way. If this contract is concluded and the person who is in India negotiates the most important part of it, it's not to be avoided. Yeah, there's nothing you can do really about that. Unless you do it completely from Germany, you don't enter India, but this is going to be difficult in a way. Yeah. So, if you're just doing market research, stay with the liaison office. But then, yeah, you're more on the less safe side. Liaison office cannot do any profit earnings, so you're not attached to any marketing or information handing out or research, feasibility studies, then you're on the safe side under this structure. Any more questions?
Thank you very much, and very informative presentation, I say. And also, you've covered some key issues from your topic with respect to each other states. So now, as per the agenda, we go to one another state, which also you mentioned, the Tamil Nadu, and what this state has to offer.
Tamil Nadu, the investor's paradise. India is a land of rich natural resources and diverse climatic conditions. With strong market fundamentals and highly conducive business environment for greater global participation. One of the fastest growing economies in the world, India is the 7th preferred investment destination according to an UNCTAD survey. Of all the Indian states, Tamil Nadu is the fastest growing state economy. With its consistent growth, Tamil Nadu is a paradise for global investors. It holds 17% of state share of India's factories, 16% of state share in India's industrial workforce, and 11% share of the industrial output. The state contributes more than 8,000 megawatts of renewable energy, about 28%, the highest percentage by an Indian state, holds 15% of India's coal capacity, and is the second largest GDP contributor of the country at 8.4%. With 48.5% population living in urban areas, Tamil Nadu is India's most urbanized state by geography and population. Tamil Nadu ranks first in terms of domestic tourist arrivals, second in foreign tourist arrivals in the country, and third in terms of cumulative FDI flows. Tamil Nadu, with the highest number of technical universities, beckons opportunities for global investors. The Tamil Nadu government has allotted about 48,000 acres of additional land for industries. With business opportunities in textiles, automobile and auto ancillary, biotech and pharmaceuticals, aerospace, renewable energy, heavy engineering, IT and ITES, electronic hardware and infrastructure, Tamil Nadu boasts of a strong urban, social and educational infrastructure. Different businesses, different people, and a whole lot of dreams, Tamil Nadu opens up a world of business opportunities across diverse sectors. To expand the growth prospects of the state and to showcase it as the most preferred investment destination, the government of Tamil Nadu is organizing Global Investors Meet in Chennai as it prepares to roll out the red carpet to investors around the globe, realizing the state's vision to seek growth in employment, regional development, and an all-inclusive growth through investment inflows.
So the next presentation is from Mr. Joe Podel. I think I spelled it right. Podel. He's going to show some highlights on the legal aspects.
Yeah. Kupi, thank you for inviting me. Okay. Thank you. I love that word, risk-sharing partnerships, and I think that's created by you, and it's a good buzzword showing the work which German and Indian companies can do together. So I'm now, since more than 20 years in that business, advising joint ventures, technical collaboration agreements, license agreements, and so on. And I want to show you some highlights of that. So, first of all, the environment for foreign investments in Germany. So I see many people from India, I think so, who want to invest in Germany. And vice versa, the investment surroundings in India are very positive. So both countries really appreciate investments. And the domestic and foreign investors in both countries are actually treated equally. So nearly equally. So we have some regulations in Germany. So since 2004, we have a screening mechanism for very sensitive computer industry or roboters or so on. So the KUKA case is very famous actually with the Chinese. But normally there is nearly no restriction in investing in Germany. On the other hand, we have FDI regulations in India, but they are very low hurdles. So in the 1990s, it was quite difficult to invest, or even before that. We had actually compulsory joint ventures, but now nearly every sector is free for entering India. Unfortunately, we have no Indo-German investment treaty since 2017, so that is still missing. So we are hoping that we get a new treaty in the future, but at the moment I think there is no talk in that regard. But however, we have Hermes, yeah, protecting investments, and there are other means by protecting your investments. First of all, you need good contracts, and first of all, you need good partners in the business. So these are the main vehicles, the joint ventures, the technical collaboration agreements, and the license and distribution agreements. And from the joint venture point of view, there is a big debate whether it's good or bad. And actually, there is no good or bad answer to that. I know clients who were very lucky with their investment in India in a joint venture. I know one of my clients is now, he got a millionaire in India. He's sitting on a nice island in Sylt, one of the most expensive places in Germany, and said, well, that was the greatest decision I ever made, investing in India. And there are others saying, oh God, that was the worst decision I ever made, I have only trouble. So, I will show you the secrets of success in a nutshell. And first of all, you have to think about the scope of the joint venture. Many clients are not focusing. Yeah? Especially Indian clients are very saying, oh, I can do that, and I can do that, and I can do so much. And they have four business cards with four different businesses. So it's very, very difficult to focus. And the Germans very often say, well, let's start, and they have not a clear business plan. Yeah, they have no control, no clear vision, and these are the big mistakes in the beginning. So, if you want to start, think about funding, think about the business plan, and think about the decision making in the joint venture. So, many clients cannot decide who is in the driving seat, actually, yeah, who has the power to make decisions in that company. And many say, especially in the Mittelstand, oh, let's do a 50-50 joint venture. And later on, things will sort out. We'll have a look at it later on. Let's see in 2 years. Yeah? And I know abandoned joint ventures, yeah, who really did not get started. You need a deadlock mechanism, which is very important. Yeah? So what happens if there is no decision? Yeah, you need an exit scenario if necessary, how to get out of that business. And you need to be clear. The director's liability is very important. And it is in Germany and in India actually nearly the same. Yeah, in Germany it is die Sorgfalt eines ordentlichen Geschäftsmanns, yeah, that means you have to work with due diligence. And in India, it's exactly the same. And you can go for prison in Germany or in India if you're not compliant. So many joint ventures partners in Germany, they are a Geschäftsführer in the mother company, and they say, okay, I'm director in the Indian company, but they don't care. They don't go there, they don't talk with the people, they don't have a look at the factory, they should do so. And we have many interesting cases, and abandoning a company is not an option. And you have to have a clear plan, and you cannot just say, I won't have a look at the company anymore. So to me, people came and said, well, look, I have those shares in that company, and I'm a director, but I have no contact to my joint venture partner anymore. So avoid that. Then some people are blocking themselves with non-compete provisions. In the past, until 2011, in India we had the non-objection certificates. Yeah? So if you wanted to leave a joint venture, an Indo-German joint venture, you needed a special paper. Yeah? So a non-compete paper from your partner saying, well, you can make another business. And that was difficult to obtain at that time. But that was abandoned in 2011, so you are free normally when you go to another joint venture partner, or if you want to start your own business in India, things are now very easy from a legal point of view. So, the secrets of success in a nutshell. So I'm telling you just in a very, very short way things about India or the other way around about Germany, which is not true. So everything you say about India is true, and the opposite is true too. So it's a big country, many people, and when I'm telling about India, so my son, who just returned from the Indian Institute of Technology in Chennai, he was 1 year there, said, you have no clue of India. You don't understand this country because we see different worlds. Be careful. I know people who were very happy with their joint ventures and technical collaboration agreements, and I saw people really in desperation. So what are the secrets of success? First of all, a very German word, Trau, Schau, Wem. Yeah? So if you just meet somebody on the airport or on a trade fair, be careful. Yeah? Check, make a background check. There are very good background checks by, for instance, the Indo-German Chamber of Commerce or Kreditreform or whoever. You would do it in your own country. So Indians are doing that, Germans are doing that. But within Indo-German joint ventures, it's very seldomly done. I'm very astonished. Yeah? And later on, people say, oh, look, I have a very special partner. Yeah? I think he's a criminal, or the other way around. So Indians investing in Germany have no clue who is your partner, actually. Yeah? And I've seen Indians who were in a very bad situation in Germany as well. Second, a very simple thing, business plan. Make a business plan for 3, 5, 10 years, yeah? And a joint business plan with your partner. Third, protect your IP rights. We had a very difficult case, the Anacon case, with the windmills. You know that case probably? Which was really a disaster. And was not a good advertisement for Indo-German joint ventures. So they were struggling over their IP rights. And it was not clear whether the IP rights with the joint venture company, or with the German company, or with the Indian company. And then I think they are still in arbitration since more than 10 years. Go for arbitration. Yeah. India is a beautiful country, it's great, but the courts are completely overloaded. Yeah. It takes, for the first instance, nearly 10 years. So arbitration is a good means for getting peace in your joint venture. Yeah. International arbitration, Singapore arbitration, not a big thing. You should care and control. I know many German joint venture partners who say, oh, I don't want to control, I don't want to ask, yeah. That looks very arrogant when I go there and want to have a look to the factory. That's wrong. Yeah, you shouldn't care. Many Indians come to me and say, well, they're not interested in our joint venture. I didn't hear anything from them since 2 years. Yeah, what happened? A very special joint venture was very important company and well-known, I cannot tell you the name, they didn't look 10 years for the Indo-German joint venture. And after 10 years, there was a change in ownership. So the father gave the business to the son, and the son came to me and said, look, I have a company in India, but I do not know what it is. Can we have a look at it? Yeah. So caring and controlling is very important. And good and regular communication. So the millionaire, I told you in the beginning, he went down every 3 months at least. He went to functions, family functions, he had a good contact to the family owning the partnership. And then there was a good understanding. It was so easy to just pick up the phone because he went down every 3 months, and they had tea together and coffee together, and it was a very good joint venture and very successful. So it's actually very easy, but many people don't do it. Thank you very much.
I just want to add to what you said. So you were mentioning that there is no Indo-German treaty. I'm assuming what you're trying to say. So I just wanted to add that we do have a cooperation agreement with the EU, under whose ambit trade with Germany also is covered. Further, we have a lot of institutional mechanisms which oversee trade between India and Germany. So we've got joint working groups, we've got joint commission. We've also got joint working groups on specific sectors like automotives, energy, and certain other sectors also. And then we have foreign office consultations, and on top of that we have intergovernmental consultations between the heads of the states also. So there are several mechanisms overseeing trade between the just wanted to add.
Yeah, thank you very much. So I would be very interested to learn more about that.
Yeah, we could
but,
share.
But what discussed is at the moment, the German side is discussing why do we not have a formal investment treaty.
Yeah, I think that's also because we are consulting on a free trade agreement with the EU, which was suspended.
Exactly.
So
exactly.
2 months that takes over the EU with Germany within the EU.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. And the next state in focus for today is the state of Karnataka. And let's see what Karnataka has to offer. This video was done without any oral commentary, but then the visuals are self-explanatory.
Thank you.
after this, we have with us Dr. Nagaraj Salagundala to give us some details on the innovation and technology management arena. May I request Mr. Nagaraj to please come up and...
Excellency, Madam Crater, learned colleagues and friends, good evening. I'm from the Frankfurt world, probably the colleagues team here who give the worthy nice speakers, they do know a lot about. And just to give a brief, we are 72 institutes, and from one of them, called the Frankfurt Center for International Management and Knowledge Economy. So, I mean, like, as I said, so planning is the most important thing, and for that we have a mission and a vision. Because applied research is the foundation for any of the industry. And this is where, I mean, like, whenever we have guests and friends from India, they want to look at how we are trying to manage this research-oriented application. And once we had guests Goyal at our institute, and he said how it would be wonderful for us if we can devise a kind of the application-oriented research which could really bring innovation into the ground reality. I mean, like here, why we do, and this kind of strategy, structure, process, and instruments, and how we do the transfer of knowledge and technology between the organizations. So the implementation of knowledge and innovation and understanding and designing. This is the basic core of the German engineering. I mean, like without that, they wouldn't be the masters what they are right now. So just to give, thank you. So just to give you an overview of this Fraunhofer Gesellschaft or Fraunhofer Society, so we are almost 72 institutes with 2.3 billion euros turnover. I mean, like, here the important thing that we tried to explain to Mr. Goyal during his visit under IGC, Indo-German Consultation, to Leipzig, the Fraunhofer Institute. What we told him, like, look, this is the 70%, we're supported by the industry, like VDMA and other colleagues who are here today. And 30% is supported by the federal government, and 29% by the federal government, and 1% by the state government. So this is where we try to drive the real research and application into the industry, and the industry can utilize our services and get into the real-time market. So the Fraunhofer, I mean, like, it's like we are in multiple fields, right, from mobility, energy, security, production, communication, and health and environment. So we have different alliances where we try to pull the expertise from different industries, which is very important. It's not that we are only into the automobile sector, we are into ICT, we are into healthcare, I mean, like, electronics, you call it. I mean, like, the 72 institutes are getting embedded into different parts of research and application, and which directly what we do is we take them directly to the industry. And support, at the same time, innovation is a very important part, and we also support from the front of the world the spin-offs, like how, I mean, this is one of the great things that I hear about India is Stand-up India, Start-up India. So probably this is where we could also see that there could be some kind of synergies between the German and the Indian innovation ecosystem. So right now, I mean, like, what is the research focus for our institute? We have these are something like innovation policy and transfer design, business models, and data mining and value creation, stakeholder dialogue and social acceptance. Probably these are some of the areas where we are working at our institute. And this would be very important in Indian context, where we try to educate the German firms about the Indian system, where they could really think and act appropriately. And customers and markets, like, we have the public sector clients, the federal states, European Commission, and of course the industry is one of our major clients, because the 70% of our revenues are from the industry, our industry driven. And what we do is, like, innovation is more than technical invention. So questions from a socio-economic perspective, like, okay, once we have everything in place, so how does it impact the society? So this is what we do at this in different situations, like, are there conflicts, concerning the user acceptance or the what happens to the stakeholders which follow the goals, how can we balance the economic, social, and ecological goals, so how does the transfer of knowledge take place in the age of digitization. So what is our approach? So our goal is a holistic approach to innovation. So what we do at Fraunhofer is like, look, we have a technology, we have a market, we have people, but what mainly drives is the policy of innovation. And this is where we try to bring the engineering, natural science, and life sciences together and put it into the economic perspective and see that it's a multi-stake case where, I mean, like this innovation really fits into. This is what we are trying to work with different other sister institutes from the front of the world and also to the industry as well. So what do we do here? So the most important thing, what we do here is the internationalization of German firms. As everyone speaks here, it's a Mittelstand. Germany doesn't run just on the big corporates like Siemens or the Volkswagen or BMW and Mercedes, but they run on the Mittelstand, which is the backbone of the economy. This is where Fraunhofer plays a key role in helping these firms in the process of internationalization. And this is where we are trying to look from the German perspective, like what's it's interdisciplinary and international. So this is what we are doing at this institute in Leipzig. Yeah, sorry. Okay, internationalization, what we do is like we conduct the applied research, what happens, and then what happens to the practical development, and is it scientifically sound to the society? Of course, we do this for most of the German SMEs here, and we're also trying to help them to reach out to the Indian and the Asian, especially in the Asian context, we're trying to do a lot of projects with them. So as as most of the people were speaking like about the southern states, one of the states which came in close contact with is Andhra Pradesh, and they say, okay guys, we are there to help you. I mean, like if there are German companies, we can definitely work on the innovation policy where Fraunhofer could be kind of advisory role. So this is a small case study that we want to present, like, okay. So it's a eighth largest state, and it's also a newborn state like Telangana, I suppose, and they have a nice, it is a gateway to the east with a total course of around 14, as of now it seems there are 6, and so they have also very good infrastructure with regards to the airports, and everyone is pointing out, every state has its own single desk policy, that's something good to know. So they say that, okay, we give you the approvals in 21 days. And they're trying to say in the labor contract, because this is one of the major things that's a real problem, how it helps, you know? So this is where they say, we try to help you guys. We have a dedicated officer, and we will see that they don't have any hiccups in any form of... it's a very nice picture that I really felt could be of very importance. It's like a coastal, they have, coastal area where they have this kind of network of industrial nodes, and they are trying to support this infrastructure by this, this is being supported by ADB, Asian Development Bank. So this is between the two states. So it runs from Vizag to the Chennai, between Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, and it's a very good, if the infrastructure, I think they're developing very good, and if this comes into place in the next year or two, probably it would be a kind of very nice for the German SMEs to make it as a gateway for the East, for their exporters, not just the Indian India or the Indian subcontinent, but also they can look at the Asian context. These are rare, this is something that's a dream, I can't believe, it's a green capital that they're trying to build. They call it a blue-green city, they have a nice industry plant, so, this is a kind where we try to tell the German firms, probably this is something that for a greenfield investment, this is an appropriate city where they can really start their venture. So what we do, currently one of my role at this front of IMW is like I'm working on a project for data mining and value creation. We work with the German SMEs very closely, and we are trying to look at how they are helping the German, how the German industry is placed, especially the SMEs. So we are looking into the socio-economic part, like the possible use of data, database business models, and of course our a partner university, we're working closely with them. Like this is a federal government funded project along with the industry to the tune of 7.5 million euros. So this is where we're trying to help the German, and mostly the automobile sector, where the digitization process is still lacking. When we compare with the American standards, of course the Chinese are picking that, Germans are, this is where the industry 4.0 comes into play. Probably this is also where we try to tell these German companies, hey, if this is something like there's a kind of relationship between India and Germany, that the IT infrastructure and the IT skill are very good, probably this makes sense for you guys to go to India, and this is the right time. So this in brief about Fraunhofer IMW, what we are doing as an institute in Leipzig. So thank you very much for your kind attention. So if you have any question about the Fraunhofer world, I would be very happy to.
So if, as a SMI, I would like to get in contact with the Fraunhofer, are these projects that are, so who finances this project? And you know, you basically facilitate the cross-border investment by, you know, showing what opportunities there are and how you can internationalize. But who, at the end of the day, I mean, me as an SMI, for example, how is this financed and done?
As you know, there's a Fraunhofer Gesellschaft.
Yes.
There's a society. We are funded to the tune of 30% by the
yes.
government itself.
Yes.
So we have some basic funding. Once if we want to have our services as an industry, so probably the next 70%, which is as per the norms, so we are not a profit-oriented organization.
Yeah.
So the SME, which is willing to talk to us, and there are different associations like BDME
yes.
and other IHACAs, so they try to support this again, these SMEs.
Yes.
They together form a kind of small group, and then they come to Fraunhofer.
Mm.
So we do the due diligence
mm.
and we try to help them because we have these tools so already developed at the institute
yeah.
for quite last one decade.
Yes, yes, yes.
So this is how it works. So the burden doesn't fall on the SME alone.
Yes.
So there are other supporting structures.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah, a part of my question has already answered. I wanted to ask you how do you differentiate between Fraunhofer and PwC, for example?
Oh,
absolutely, we are the
same.
Okay.
SME has to pay everything to them.
Absolutely, it's a good question. So PwC is definitely a profit organization,
yeah.
you know. So they depend on the profits. But whereas the Fraunhofer, this is a very typical model where Obama came here and talked to this industry guys and said, hey, we would like to make this model possible in US. He called this Make in America. So where, like as you said, the PwC, definitely they are consulting, but we as a Fraunhofer Institute, we have a close association with 71 other institutes,
mm-hmm.
and these 71 other institutes are closely associated with the industry. Like most of something they want to develop, for example, e-vehicles. We have a Fraunhofer Institute in Dresden, which has a close cooperation with Volkswagen, and of course BMW. So again, there's a trust factor. We differentiate. When this Volkswagen comes to us, okay, they say, okay, this is something, a battery that we would really like to test. So we have all the facilities there. We try to test and see that it's market ready.
Okay, so if I'm a startup, for example, manufacturing e-batteries
yeah.
for motorbikes.
You're right.
Which is now a big thing in India because
yeah.
The Delhi government, for example, has come up with an e-vehicle policy.
Mm.
And I think it will be a ripple effect and everyone will come up with something. So if I'm a startup with a e-battery company.
Technology.
Yeah, so how do you as Fraunhofer help me? Do I pay you for, or do you help me with the market studies and entry and stuff like that, or it's not part of, or you only focus on the industry?
There are some states, for example, state of Andhra Pradesh was in close contact with us, state of Tamil Nadu was also very much interested to talk to us. These are the different states. They try to bring in their startup companies like yours. There's one Telangana Hub, T Hub, something like. These guys come and talk to us and say, hey, can we have a close association with Fraunhofer? startup, I mean, like we, as we said, we also look into the spin-offs. So because, as you said about the battery technology, we have a very good Fraunhofer Institute in Dresden, which really caters to the battery technology, right from the bikes to the, right now we have one more project with e-bikes, so how it would be like to make it a more site-friendly. So if you guys are really closely interested, one way is to come through the particular government, or the government of India. Otherwise, you can also directly talk to us as an institute. We will see what is the possibility.
So you only do the market analysis or testing the products, or do you also work on skill development topics also?
Yes, skill development is not a, I mean, like we don't do it wholly, but we see even right now, for example, for the, I mean, there was a good question, like you were speaking about the dual education system here, but the more than dual education system is at the higher level, but when it comes to the basic industry, there's like Beruf Schule system, I mean, like they have 353 trades, like right from fifth class, he's decided in which stream he goes. Only one third goes into the gymnasium, like they will go into the university, only one third go. The remaining two thirds, they go into the vocational courses, this Beruf Schule system. Like what he said is true, like the companies try to support them, paying them around 600 to 1,000 euros, depending on the company and the place of business. So it's not a problem because as he said, you know, that's a very good observation. Like, yeah, he's getting trained and we are paying him. Does he leave our company? It doesn't matter, someone else is in the market. It's like market is balanced. So this is something that, I mean, like we are doing that. For example, digitalization of the Beruf Schule system is done at our institute. We have around 2 million euros funded by the federal government of Germany and also the industry associations like VDMA and other IHACAs, so industry, handels and commerce. So this is something that we try to impress upon the visiting minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal, at our institute. Like, look guys, if you want to have real, I mean like labor skills, it doesn't come from somewhere. Like the IITs are there, but they are not really equipped. I mean like, yeah, you have the best equipment, at the end of the day, it lies there and nothing happens. So if we can really, I mean like, there are two ways of approach for this. One is like doing something like, okay, a kind of cosmopolitan, like, okay guys, we try to do a kind of body shopping. We try to have the trainer masters doing this kind of training for these industries in India. That's one approach, a kind of temporary, but there could be a kind of paradigm shift. Like, okay, we don't really adapt the German system, but a kind of bring that system a little bit closer to the Indian condition and develop this kind of Beruf Schule system. Here they start at fifth class, I suppose. And instead we could do it at seventh class or eighth class in India. That would be absolutely the best step for the Make in India campaign. However, the Prime Minister is great that he's trying to push in this Make in India campaign. But at the end of the day, it's skill that's important. What you said is skill development. We do at the Fraunhofer for the German institutions. So this is one of our priority areas because digitization is something new. I mean, unless something we do in the Beruf Schule system or the vocational schools here in Germany, they won't really catch it.
Wonderful. So at that note, thank you very much. And we move on to the next topic. And further questions, we do have a network session. Maybe one-on-one discussions can be taken on.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Next, we have the last state to present today is Andhra Pradesh in our focus. And
Andhra Pradesh, a state with a strong economy, a bustling industrial scene, and an enabling business environment. A state that is working towards claiming its destiny as the most developed state in India by the year 2029. A state that wants to build on the solid pillars of abundant natural resources and a growing industrial base, on a platform called knowledge and a springboard called self-development. An infrastructure backbone that will knit our many urban hubs with the countless rural activity centers into one holistic state of promise and prosperity. With planned and sustained interventions in administration and policy, economic initiatives and value enhancers like capacity building, skill development, innovations and research. With 24/7 quality power, abundant water supply, ample land, transparent administration and visionary leadership, we are embarking on a journey that will harness our potential and develop opportunities in all sectors, from food processing to petrochemicals, from automotives to minerals, from chemicals to textiles, and many more. Tourism experience that integrates the magic of the most picturesque and natural regales with a buzz of world-class smart cities. It is our vast network of educational and learning centers that will act as a true differentiator. While the highlights of this journey will be India's second largest coastline, with modern ports having state-of-the-art infrastructure, with rail and road connectivity, airports and logistics hubs, making up a network of convenience, and metro rails poised to change traffic patterns. It is the planned cluster-based development of the state that will see it emerge as a logistics hub, as the LNG gateway to India, with a fully integrated inland waterway transport system, with smart urban infrastructure designed to keep pace with development, and with industrial corridors that pave the way to the future. Andhra Pradesh is ready. The people have set their sights and rolled up their sleeves. Support systems are in place. Dedicated country desks. Investor facilitation set. Online single desk system. One of the best environments in terms of ease of doing business and best-in-class policies. Yes, the roadmap has been laid. The journey has begun. We are forging ahead and we are looking for fellow travelers. And you are a special invitee. Andhra Pradesh. A state geared to welcome the future.
Great. So with that, we come to the last presentation of today. That's Mayu. And so going towards the whole objective of today's conference, which is to promote Indo-German business collaboration through risk-sharing partnerships, in my presentation, I'm going to cover what it exactly means. And before stepping into that, I'd like to briefly highlight what's going on with India in terms of its economic progress, in terms of its GDP figures. India embarked on globalization since 1990, and since then, how the ranking of India in terms of its GDP. We hardly see India in the top 10 list until 2012.
Thank you.
became the sixth or seventh largest economy in terms of its GDP. And there are two parameters of GDP. One is what is spoken in today's economic figures. There is another approach is purchase power parity. And in that, India already stands third in the world with respect to its GDP. So that shows the economic progress. Well, it may not be capturing the same results to all industries, depending upon the focus of each respective industry. What's quite interesting that I found of late is a research by Oxford Economics, where they published an interesting analysis about the cities as the growth engines in the global GDP trends. And the research has taken some 700 large cities worldwide and how in these cities the GDP was progressing. And we see among those listed cities in the rest of Asia, 15 of them. In India, we have 3 of them. Now, the top 10 or top list of these big cities with respect to GDP. And the names we already see are from US, that is New York, Tokyo, Los Angeles, London, Shanghai, etc. But we don't see anyone from India. What's interesting to me is the next slide, where they also have categorized top 10 growth cities in terms of the growth rate of GDP in those cities, meaning to say the growth potential of the particular city. And in this list, we see the entire top 10 growth cities were from India. So, which is a positive point to look at for industries in terms of where can I put money so that I can grow. You know, that's that is one approach. And the other aspect, the also a reason why we chose these 4 states is based on this slide that you see among these top 10 cities. This is a world ranking, not just India's ranking, but all the cities are from India. And we see among them Bangalore, Hyderabad, Chennai, and Vijayawada. These are the state capitals of the 4 cities that we have selected today for our presentation. And that is the geographical location of these cities in India. They are majorly in the south of India. Now, coming to Indo-German partnerships, what we have been doing from Bloomen Group is that organize seminars and workshops, and we have done them in India, in Karnataka, in Bangalore city, along with Pradesh of Karnataka Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And then we also done similar kind of presentations in Vijayawada, along with Andhra Chamber of Commerce. And we also done in Hyderabad with Pradesh of Andhra Pradesh Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Now, as part of these workshops, we were trying to identify what the interests or underlying motivations of these companies with respect to internationalization or globalization. That was the whole focus when we were interacting with these industries. And now we have started this campaign from Hamburg. We have been doing these workshops, and now in Frankfurt, 3rd of June, we are going to do it in Munich. Besides the participants who are present during the conferences, we are also getting emails and other ways of communication with interesting companies. And the idea is to create, on a longer run, a company-based profiling of these interesting companies which are approaching us, and then do a matchmaking of those companies when they have mutual interest or some sort of overlapping areas where they can potentially be a partner. So that's the first point of finding where there is potential for partnerships, and then taking to the next level of identifying the risk areas and how to mitigate those risks is the second step. We are trying to do it with business delegations and conferences. So besides conferences like this, we are going to do a kind of a roadshow in India, in Hyderabad, Chennai, Bangalore, and Vijayawada, where we are trying to connect with the local industry and try to bring a delegation of interesting companies to Germany towards September or October of 2019 is our final target towards which we are moving step by step. And also in association with some of the German organizations and universities, we are trying to conduct some development workshops to get a deeper understanding about going for a longer partnerships in terms of business. Well, we have support of speakers and various institutions time to time, and through them we are confident that we'll be able to deliver what we are focusing on. Thank you. Yeah, so if you have any questions, or then I'm done. So,
thank you very much, both for coordinating all of this for the consulate. As a small token of appreciation, I'd like to first invite our consul for commerce and political, Mr. Vijaswi, to hand over a small token to all our speakers who've traveled from all over the place. So first I'd like to invite Ms. Iris Winkler, ladies first. She's joined us from Prague for this event. I'd also like to add that Iris works very closely with the Indian Consulate, has been very, very close with India operations, with the PwC India operations. Thank you so much, Iris, for
that. Always a pleasure to do that.
Thank you. Thank you. Then we have the other speaker from Bristol Law who's joined us, Dr. York Patel. He is also the president of the German India Roundtable, I would like to add.
Thank you.
And at the same time, he has written some very complicated books on tax systems in India. So I have a copy of his book, but I have to confess I've not been able to read or understand myself. But yeah, thank you very much for
that.
Then I'd like to invite Oliver Bach, Mr. Oliver Bach, who's from BDMA, also a very close friend of India.
Nice to meet you.
Yes, and for your
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. Mr. Bach also operates very closely with the BDMA's India office and often travels to India. So he's really very well conversant with Indo-German trade partnerships. So then I'd like to invite Dr. Nagaraj from the Fraunhofer Institute. And he's also come all the way from Pakistan. Thank you very much for sharing your inputs with us today.
It's my pleasure, and I really look forward to work with you from the Fraunhofer world. And of course, all these, most of them are our clients, customers on the other side. Probably we'll try to pull it. It's great to have them on our board.
Yes.
Probably we can pull in more energy into this, enthusiasm into this, and thanks to Gopi. Hopefully you are going to some more events like this. Okay, thank you very much.
And finally, may I invite Mr. Gopi Prasad Gopi for putting the show through, coordinating with our speakers. And I'd now like to invite all of us for some tea and samosa. Just checking. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
They always have a lot, and so we had some meetings and some, we have our summit, you know, where, you know, one day from morning to evening you have the opportunity to talk to people who do the operative business in India, and that is of course very helpful.